beautifully. And I'm thankful for the plain word of the Lord this morning. And in a time when we could use some help, I want to encourage all of us to look for the helpers. So you may already know about my love for Fred Rogers, right? Or as he's also known, Mr. Rogers. And if you don't know who he is, or if you weren't here when I last preached about him, he was the host of a children's television show called Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And that ran from 1968 all the way to 2001. Ran for a long time. Now, in his show, he talked to children about what it means to have a neighbor, what it means to be a part of a community, which is really significant and really interesting that he would teach children how to be in community because he was also a Presbyterian minister. And you know, to us Presbyterians, community is a big deal. Being in community and covenant with one another is a big deal. And the fact that he was a minister might explain some of the wisdom and the love and the peace that was in his messages. Now, one of his most well-known pieces of wisdom actually came from his mother, and it's been circulated for years, and you've probably heard it, but I'll let you tell him, I'll let him tell you what this piece of wisdom is.
My mother used to say, a long time ago, whenever there would be any real catastrophe that was in the movies or on the air, she would say, always look for the helpers. There will always be helpers. You know, even just on the sidelines. That's why I think that if news programs could make a conscious effort of showing rescue teams, of showing who, medical people, anybody who is coming into a place where there's a tragedy, to be sure that they include that. Because if you look for the helpers, you'll know that there's hope.
Always look for the helpers. It's a beautiful piece of wisdom, amen. And in today's tumultuous times, I think back on Fred Rogers' advice. And I grab a little bit of hope for myself. In times like these, it's not just helpful, but it's necessary for your own sanity to look for the helpers, amen? Helpers like Elder Cornelius Moore of Battlehorn Lighthouse Ministries or Reverend Jeff Hood of Cathedral of Hope in Dallas. These are but two of the many clergy who were highlighted in a recent BuzzFeed article that took a look at the role of clergy in the peacekeeping efforts right now in Ferguson, Missouri. In the days after Michael Brown's death, after he was shot and killed by a police officer, this community of Ferguson is still looking for answers, and tensions have risen steadily in response to what some people feel as a heavy-handed approach to protesters by the police. But amidst the tensions, amidst the demonstrations and the tear gas, one can still spot the helpers. Those blessed peacemakers who Jesus said would be called the children of God. They're the nuns who provide a safe space for the youth in Ferguson to shout and to vent their frustrations. They're the churches who open their doors for prayer and who give shelter for those who have come from outside of the community just to help. They're there, the shining points of light in the midst of darkness. And today, we read about a few of my all-time favorite helpers. We have a Pharaoh who is completely disconnected from history and is irrationally afraid of the growing Hebrew population in Egypt. It's the kind of xenophobia, to which we are no strangers in 21st century America, where we can't even get true immigration reform passed because some people just don't want any more of them to come here, whoever they are. And his irrational hatred not only leads to the enslavement and the oppression of the Hebrews, but he even goes as far as trying to kill their babies. The babies, y'all. The babies. And no, we're not strangers to that kind of xenophobia who makes children who want to come across this border to get away from the strife in their country. They're not even safe. He tells the Hebrew midwives to kill the baby boys as soon as they're born. Simply detestable. But Shipra and Koa, these Hebrew midwives, they had other designs. And in a beautiful act of civil disobedience, they refused to kill these babies. Instead, they lied to Pharaoh and said, well, you know, Pharaoh, these Hebrew women, they're strong. They're not like your Egyptian women now. They're strong. You know, they have these babies before we can even get there. So to get around that, Pharaoh tells all the people in Egypt that every Hebrew boy should be thrown into the Nile. Every Hebrew baby boy, whether they're born or about to be born, should be thrown into the Nile. Now, there was a Levite couple who gave birth to a little boy, and they hid him until they could no longer hide him. To give him a chance at life, his mama puts him in a papyrus basket, and she places that basket in the Nile River, just hoping that he would have a chance. And his big sister Miriam stays with that basket. She follows it to watch over him, and he ends up in the most unlikely of places, the very palace of Pharaoh. Pharaoh! And it would be Pharaoh's daughter who finds him and who looks at him and takes pity on him. And they would call him Moses. It sounds like the word Moshe. It means to draw out, because she drew him out of the water, and he would later draw his people out of Egypt. And you know, since Miriam had been following him, she said, hey, I know someone who can nurse him. So his very own mother got to take care of him and get paid for it. Tell me God isn't good. But just imagine this though. Pharaoh is so afraid of these little Hebrew boys, and he doesn't think anything about the Hebrew girls and women. They're cunning, they're intelligence. It's only the helpers in this situation that can make a story about slavery and oppression and genocide and infanticide a source of hope and a source of assurance. It's only the helpers who can make something that ugly into something so beautiful. Without these helpers, this story is completely gloomy, and it's without redemption of any kind. It's the helpers who encourage us to go on in the face of evil. It's the helpers who assure us that all is not lost and God is not finished. It's the helpers who make the uncomfortable times bearable. So what if, and this is a rhetorical question, what if the Bible is challenging us to be those helpers? It is. It is. In Romans chapter 12, Paul is imploring the Roman church to present themselves as living sacrifices. Shipra and Pua, they were living sacrifices. Right now, these clergy and these community organizers and these activists that are in Ferguson, they are living sacrifices. They did not conform to the xenophobic, fear-mongering ways of this world. They are transformed by having their minds renewed. Renewed toward God and away from self. Renewed toward love of neighbor and away from separation from other people. The helpers are the embodiments of sacrifice. They're eschewing what's comfortable for them and what's beneficial for them. They're instead bringing comfort to other people, bringing benefit to other people. In that way, they mirror the ultimate sacrifice, that of Jesus Christ on the cross. What's more is that the helpers themselves give help. The helpers have help. They're not asked to do something and then left to figure things out on their own. They are, in fact, empowered by the Most High God to help. Paul points out to a Roman church whose members were flirting with selfishness and self-aggrandizement that all of us, every single last one of us, is equipped for the work of God. In other words, we each have been gifted spiritually for the job to which we are called. Not some of us, but all of us. All of us. We are created and empowered to be the helpers who bring redemption to the evil and ugly stories. When Fred Rogers' mother told him to look for the helpers, she wasn't just talking about a select few group of people. She was talking about all of us. All of us have the power and the ability and the calling to be helpers. And so my loving encouragement to all of us today is not to just look for the helpers, but to look for the helper in you. Look for the helper in you. Look to be the helper. Who are you in the body of Christ? Are you the arms who embrace a brother and sister in their pain? Are you the hands who get dirty in the messy work of rebuilding community? Are you the mouth with a prophetic word of hope, of challenge, or of encouragement? Are you the feet? Are you the feet that walk in solidarity with people who would normally have to walk alone? Whatever you are, you're something. You're something. You are a part of the body of Christ, and you therefore have a purpose. None of us is an appendix. We still don't know what an appendix is. What is an appendix? None of you are a supernumerary digit. You're not a sixth finger or a sixth toe that has no function. You're useful. None of you are superfluous or without purpose. You have a purpose. You have a job. And do not be afraid to do that job, please. Because even the helpers have a helper. When you feel like you're not qualified to do something, remember, you have a helper. When you feel that the job is overwhelming and it's a bit more than you're prepared to handle, remember, you have a helper. You have a helper whose strength is made perfect in your weakness. You have a helper who has a cattle on 1,000 hills. You have a helper who supplies all your needs according to his glorious riches. You have a helper who couldn't even be stopped by death, crucifixion, the grave, and if nothing can stop that helper, nothing can stop you. You have a helper who's more powerful than you ever need to be. Brothers and sisters, if nothing can stop that helper, nothing can stop you. Look for the helpers. More importantly, look for the helper in you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Gracious God, sometimes we just don't know how to respond to the tragedy and the turmoil that we see, Lord God. Lord, help us to focus on your work in the midst of those things. But Lord, more importantly, help us to find the helper that is within us. Show us if we're unsure of what our job is to be. We know we have a job. Help us not to shirk that responsibility, Lord, but remind our spirits, our hearts, to walk in power because we have the Most High, all-powerful God on our side. We are commissioned by a God who is more powerful than we need to be. And so we shouldn't be afraid of our calling. We shouldn't be afraid of what role we play in the body of Christ. Lord, help us to operate in boldness and in God confidence. The Lord, you have promised to never leave nor forsake us. Help us believe that today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And since we do have a helper, let us respond by singing this blessed hymn of the church, Our God, Our Help in Ages Past. Will you stand?